Christ living undivided right.
You need a strong east wind. You need a strong east wind to blow out your preconceived ideas. You need a strong east wind to blow out your religion. You need a strong east wind to blow out the doctrine of the scribes and Pharisees, which still possess your soul because you've not allowed the Holy Ghost to move in you and set you free.
A ministry with a vision. A ministry on the move. A ministry established by our faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Think what God wants to do in his people is make his supernatural Holy Ghost fire and power clear to our sight, clear to our mind, so that there is no doubt in our spiritual creation who God is.
Bible for Christ Love International Ministry, a ministry with a vision built on a plan.
God. Oh, yes, Lord. Fill this place with your presence. Oh, God, open up those floodgates, Lord. Even in this next year, Lord, open up those floodgates, God. And let that presence sweep over our soul. Oh, yes, Lord. We give it all to you, God. There is nothing else in my life more important. Oh, than just sitting at your feet. If I never get to do anything else, Lord, it's just to sup with you. Oh, to let your presence engulf me. To let it overtake God. Oh, begin to set your face upon the Lord. Cry out to him. Oh, open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain. Oh, yes, Lord. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain. Oh, let it rain.
Oh, yeah.
God, we want you to
open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain.
Let your presence rain.
Let it
begin to open the floodgates of heaven. Begin to fill this place with your anointing. Oh, we want your presence, Lord. We want you, Lord, to have your way. Oh, have your way. We set our faces to you. There's no one like you, Lord. There's no one like you, Lord. There's no one like you, Lord. Yes, we give ourselves to you. There's no one like you, Lord. Oh, yes, there's no one like you, Lord. There's no one like you, Lord. We give Undarabasi, just wait. Just wait on him. Just like they did in the upper room. They sat in one accord. They all had their eyes on him. They all waited. They waited for his presence to fall. Holy Ghost, have your way. There it comes. It'll flood this place like never before. Oh, Narabasi, just wait right there. He's right over you. Oh, yes, let that fire. Oh, yes, let it break. Let it break in this place. Oh, yes, it's a new year. It's a new year. It's a new year. Oh, yes, Lord, it's a new year. Oh, yes, Lord, a great anointing will come. Oh, as you break yourself before the Lord, that's when that anointing begins to flow upon you. It's when you break yourself before the Lord. It's when you stand there, hallelujah, and you let God have his way, and you don't get in the way of God, but you let him move upon you. Don't hold anything back. This is a new year. God clean this house. God, by his anointing and his power, he cleaned this house and prepared it for a great move. Hamalamashanda, don't stand back, but come to the altar. Come and give it all to him. He's looking for you to give everything to him. Give it all to him. 2023 will be a great year, but it takes a great sacrifice. It takes you giving it all. Give it all to him. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, Lord. Have your way. Have your way, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. We surrender to you. Oh, yes, we wait. Just like they did in that upper room. In the process of waiting. Oh, Narabasi. Oh, it's to get rid of you. To get rid of you. To get rid of what you think. To get rid of what you want. To get rid of your opinions and your ideas. And let him move. Let him move in a great way. Let him move in this place. Oh, yes. He opened the floodgates. He opened them. They are open. They are open for you right now. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, God. It is raining in this place. Oh, it is raining in this place. Oh, fresh anointing. Have your way. Have your way. Have your way in this place. We wait on you. It's so precious. Oh, Narabasi. Oh, yeah. Open.
A ministry that is established by our faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Our theme, this revival, is raising the standard of excellence. When I hear the word excellent, I am reminded of a memory very strong in my mind. When I was in school and I would study or I would do an assignment, if I received excellent on my paper, I felt so good inside. Just the fact that I exceeded a letter grade, and especially the fact that my teacher acknowledged I was maybe a little above average and I got excellent. That is as far close as you can get to perfect as possible. Well, the Word of God says that God's name alone is excellent. So when we hear the name of the Lord, it's about as perfect as you can get. If I speak the name Yeshua HaMashiach or Yahweh or Messiah or the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, if I say the God who is the healer or the creator, all right, in that moment, our mind begins to think of excellent things. And I want you to understand how powerful the name of God is. Just in his name, there is no other name above all names but the name of the Lord. If we could be a people that would just set our mind upon the name of the Lord, then we could be a people that would live our life with worship, with meaning, with exaltation, with praise. In other words, the words wouldn't be just in the Bible, but they would be alive in your temple. His glory is above the heavens and the earth. So if we want to understand anything about excellence, we must become as a student of Christ. In the Word of God, not only does his name speak of excellence, and we learn that there's an excellency about Jesus Christ, that we are all attaining to the knowledge and the excellency of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But there is also a character in the Old Testament that I am personally astounded by, and that is Daniel. You guys know Daniel? Daniel in the lion's den? Shadrach, Meshach, and Daniel? Let me tell you something about Daniel. In the time of Daniel, King Nebuchadnezzar, who was king over Babylonian, they besieged Jerusalem, conquered it, destroyed their homes, took out their rulers and their leaders. Well, in this time period, they would take the young people that they thought were brilliant and smart, and they would bring them over to Babylonian, strip them of their Jewish name, give them a Babylonian name, and then they would raise them up and educate them in their arts and their science. And one of those young men was named Daniel, and he was so remarkable in nature. And the book of Daniel, from the beginning of Daniel to the end of Daniel, says that there was no fault nor error ever found in Daniel all of his life. I find that amazing. The Word of God also says twice in the book of Daniel, for he had an excellent spirit. Now, if I'm going to understand that, and if we want to learn something about the life of Daniel, then we must realize his self-control and his self-discipline exemplified excellence to the point that he found favor with his enemies, to the point that he stood in a lion's den at the moment he never blamed God. You can research the entire book, and Daniel never blamed God. Why am I here? What have I done? He never did that. He had complete self-control, complete character. So when we sit at the feet of Jesus in a student position, one of the first things we learn about excellence is self-control. When we have chosen to walk away and be worried and be to do about anxiety, then we are all crazy. Our life becomes about comfortability and convenience. And I bet you're even a person who's a bit irritable, impatient with other people, at moments prideful, sometimes even boastful and rude. Because we've chosen to step away from Jesus, and you're surprised you have no self-control over your emotions. And when we sit at the feet of Jesus, we learn how to build this spiritual house. And it is built by wisdom and spiritual understanding. So Daniel, the very first thing he did when he came over, and historians estimate he was about age 12 to 15. And he was standing, and he was chosen to serve the king. And they had an overseer. And the overseer said, you have to partake of all the feasts that the king eat. You have to eat like the king. You have to drink the wine. And if you read the book of Daniel, he responded with such peace and self-control and wisdom. And he said, no, that is not the ways of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For I would defile the only God that I know. I will not eat of the meat that your king does or drink of your wine. And the overseer said, I cannot go back and tell King Nebuchadnezzar that. He will have my head. And Daniel said, give me 10 days and feed me, Meshach and Abednego, feed us the vegetables of the earth and the water for 10 days. The overseer said, okay, I'll do that. After 10 days, the word of God says that their physical appearance was stronger than ever. Why? Because God wants us to understand when we stand in his presence, when we remain loyal to his commandments, when we follow after God and we stand in the relationship as Daniel did with an excellent spirit, keeping control of this house. Do you know how easy it would have been for him at a young age to say, I am scared. Of course, I'll do whatever the king says. But he never at one time did that. Bring your attention to Daniel chapter 5. So now some time has passed, and a different king is in place. In verse 1, Belshazzar, the king, made a feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before the 1,000. Here they are with their little party flesh. Belshazzar, while he tasted the wine, commanded to bring the golden and silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple, which was taken in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes, his wives, and his concubines might drink therein. Do you understand what's happening? They are having a party of flesh, but they're using the vessels of God that were stolen out of the temple of God in Jerusalem. Then they brought the golden vessels that were taken out of the temple, out of the house of the Lord, which was at Jerusalem. And the king and his princes and his wives and his concubines drank there, and everybody was partaking in the party of flesh. Everybody was partaking in comfortability. Everybody was doing whatever their flesh wanted to do. They drank wine and they praised the gods of gold and of silver, of brass, of iron, of wood and stone. I'm so glad today that I don't have to praise a god of wood, stone, and brass and gold, but I can worship only one Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And in my worship, his word and his answers are true. I give God the glory today that my resurrected Lord and Savior, when I have a need, I can close my eyes and I can feel the very presence of Jesus. I thank the Lord today, even for you, that you can close your eyes, and I can tell you that. But most assuredly, I know that if you go home and you do it, and you truly, genuinely call out on the name of Jesus, the name that makes demons shake, the name that makes the devil tremble, the name above all names, if you call out upon the name of Jesus, every wall, every burden, every pain will fall. Thank my God for that today. And all over the world, people are celebrating the resurrection and the life of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And as long as there's breath in this earthen vessel, I will speak of the name of Jesus. And I will celebrate his life. And I will dedicate my life to living like he did. Though I'm not perfect, I strive that he is perfect in me. And Daniel never, ever was there found fault in him. In the same hour came forth. Now I want you to pay attention here. Here they are in their stupid flesh, in their party state, celebrating sin. And all of a sudden, in verse 5, fingers of a man's hand begin to write against the candlestick upon the plaster of the wall of the king's palace. And the king saw it as part of the hand. Can you imagine the look on his face? 1,000 people celebrating. Can you imagine the sound of silence at that moment? A hand appearing. What was the king thinking then? Then the king's countenance was changed. I bet it was. I bet he was tripping out. And his thoughts troubled him. I bet. So that the joints of his loins were loosed. Listen to me. And his knees smote one against another. He couldn't stand up. He all of a sudden lost his balance. What is that hand that just appeared and writing on the wall? You tell me right now. And the king cried to bring in the astrologers, the Chaldeans, the soothsayers. And the king spake, and he said to the wise men of Babylonian, whosoever can read this writing and show me the interpretation thereof, he shall be clothed with scarlet. And I'll put a gold chain about his neck, and I'll make him third ruler in the kingdom. And they tried. They tried to tell him the interpretation. Then came all the king's wise men, but they could not read the writing. You, your mind can never figure out a dream that God gave you. You know, Daniel had a gift, an interpretation of dreams. You and yourself can't figure out what God wants to say. Nor could they make the interpretation known to the king. This was Belshazzar greatly troubled, and his countenance changed, and his lords were astonished. I bet they were. Now the queen, by reason of words of the king and his lords, came into the banquet house, and the queen spoke, and she said, O king, live forever. But don't let your thoughts trouble you, or your countenance be changed. There is a man in the kingdom in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. And in the days of the father of light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of God was found in him, who the king Nebuchadnezzar, thy father, thy king, I say, the master magicians, astrologers, Chaldeans, and soothsayers, for as much there's an excellent spirit. There is an excellent spirit within him of knowledge and understanding, interpreting of dreams and showing of hard sentences and dissolving of doubts. They are found in Daniel. And her husband, the king, says, go get him. Now I want you, her only explanation was the spirit of God. And he has an excellent spirit within him. So they go. And they bring Daniel, and I want you to try to think of this. And she says, I have even heard that the spirit of the gods is in him of light and understanding and wisdom. And in verse 15, as they bring Daniel. And think about this. So they go and they get Daniel. And here is Daniel with the character of excellence and peace, knowing that he's facing a different king. With the gift of interpretation, he walks into this party of flesh. And the king says, I have heard of you. And you have the interpretation, and you dissolve doubts, and you can read the writing, and you can make known to me the interpretation. And if you do, Daniel, I'm going to clothe you with scarlet. I'm going to put a gold chain about your neck, and then I'll make you third ruler. Now, let me just point something out to you. Some of us, if we heard those rewards because of a gift that God had put in us, because of our pride and our flesh and not sitting at the posture of Jesus Christ and being submitted daily by the presence of the Spirit of God and the anointing of God, we would take the comfortable, convenient route and we would be moved by the gold chain and the rewards. And oh boy, is that tempting. Third ruler, that means I'm pretty good. My gift is worthy. Listen to what Daniel said. And I want you to understand what excellence he spoke with. He could have gone for all those things. He could have traded out what his father gave him. But Daniel answered in verse 17. And he said before the king, let your gifts be to yourself. And give your rewards to another. Yet I will read the writing. And I will tell you what the interpretation of. What an excellent self-controlled spirit. What a life, an example of excellence. And the story goes on. He gave the interpretation exactly as God breathed it into him. He never altered one word. And he could have been intimidated by the king. He could have been afraid. Sometimes when you and I face adversity, or we stand in the face of our enemy, or even our flesh, we will change. We will alter the truth for fear of what the devil will do to us. But he never, his entire life, he remained loyal to the one true God, and he never sold out his heritage. And the story goes on that as he told the interpretation later on through the chapter, the king was amazed, and later he was slain. He was made third ruler, but he never let it go to his head. And in verse chapter 6 and verse 3, the word of God said Daniel was preferred over the presidents and the princes because an excellent spirit was in him. And the king thought to set him over the realm. He had great rule, but throughout his entire life, he remained humble and in self-control. He remained constant in his relationship and in his loyalty to God, and he found favor even with his enemies. Thank you. Draw your attention to Proverbs 25. Thank you, Lord. The word of God says in verse 28, Proverbs 25, he that has no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls. I want to encourage you today to allow Christ to build his word in you, to get wisdom of God, light and understanding, and allow God to build up your house. We have a wonderful ministers in training program that meets with two classes twice a week in Revival for Christ Club. And through this process, those of you who have been in it now almost 2 years know that there's been a time period of correction. And I know that as you were signing up and applying for that class, that was the one thing you were afraid of. Nobody in here likes to be corrected, especially when it's in the Lord. But God says, I love those whom I correct. And there is something about correction. It helps build the house with wisdom. If we don't open ourselves up to the correction or the training that God wants to bring us through the principles and the foundation, then we are going to be stepping away from Jesus and living a life more out of fleshly convenience. And the word of God says in Psalms 141, let the righteous smite me. It shall be a kindness. David said, those that walk with you, God, let them draw the sword and correct me. I am willing to know, even in my life, where maybe I need to go farther than my grasp. You today have to get a mentality, especially if we want to strive for an excellent life like Daniel. We have to get the mentality, Lord, it's just not good enough. My path is just not good enough. Now, I want you to think about something. If you, for 1 hour of your day, turned off your cell phone, and spent that time with Jesus, what would happen? I bet you'd have less worry. You might have a little more joy, patience. Oh, you might be a little more pleasant to be around. Now, think about this. If for one day you turned off every electronic device in your home and spent that time in the presence of God, you know God brings people in our life, but we're so busy like Martha, we miss the opportunity to truly allow Christ to speak through us and minister to them. Now, God brings many opportunities for us to proclaim his glory. But because we can't spend 10 minutes at his feet, we miss the chance to allow the mantle to be manifested through us that he has really birthed in you. Now, I want you to think about this. If you, for a week, oh, this is going to be a good one. I'm going to get y'all here. If you, for a week, turned off your social media, wow, man. Huh? See, I never got an amen on that. See how connected to the flesh we are? See how much we like those likes, 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 likes? I wonder who liked my picture today. If you for a week turned off your social media and dedicated your time maybe to the house of God, to coming into the temple of God, to laying at the altar, maybe if you turned off your social media and dedicated your time to a gift God put in you. You see, this is we put the gifts God has in us at a time slot when really they ought to be dedicated at the feet of Christ. There's nothing in this life you're going to accomplish on your own. There's nothing in this life that's going to be worthy. The only moments that really count are the breaths that you breathe as sitting at the feet of Jesus Christ. And in Psalms 141, verse 5, let the righteous smite me. It shall be a kindness. Hallelujah. Change me, Lord. And let him reprove me. It shall be an excellent oil. God wants to correct. God wants to shake. God wants to beat. And God wants to press. Now, I didn't get that from myself. In our wonderful ministers in training class, we have a young man in there. We have two. We have the first class has Brother Mario. Where is he? Brother Mario is in the first class. Since he and his mother have been in this church, I remember him as a little boy standing down here just worshiping, crying out to God, looking up here at the instruments, and you could just see the desire in him. And I would always tell his mother, he's going to be a minister in this ministry someday. And as Mario began to grow, I told him, I said, Mario, I see you as a young man sitting up on the stage, licensed and ordained. Well, I want to share something with you. 15 years old, and he's in our Ministers in Train program, and he could be doing anything else with his life. And also, I got to give credit to Brother Skyland. He's in the other Ministers in Training program. These young men could be doing anything else with their life, but they are with a group of people who are endeavoring to enhance their life through the Word and the Spirit of God. They're learning how to be men of God, and we're only looking to the Bible to lead us and the Word of God. And because of that, because of the time they're putting in and depositing into their lives, there will be at some point in their life when they have to turn for an answer. They're not going to wonder who to turn to. They're going to know that the Word of God works, and they're going to know that they can cry out to the only Lord. They're going to know that they have a purpose, a place, and a calling, and in a time when so many of our young people are lost. I thank God for these young men, that they are endeavoring to follow the calls that God has for them. And there will be a day, and you mark my words, there will be a day that Mario Johnson will get up on an April celebration revival, and he will preach, and he will speak the Word of God. fine young man. I didn't say perfect. He's learning. None of us are perfect. But I will tell you this. About a week ago, he preached a 15-minute message. And in that 15-minute message, I didn't see Mario. I saw someone else. I saw the power of the Lord through him. And this is what he said. And I told my husband, we need to get a t-shirt. But this is what he said. He said, the olive in us first has to be shaken. And then it's got to be beaten. And then it's got to be pressed. And then the oil comes out. So, Maria, I hope you don't mind, but I'm recommunicating the truth here. Glory to God. Back to Psalms 141 in verse 5. So David said, Lord, smite me with kindness and reprove me. And as you do, Lord, an excellent oil is going to come out of me. We shouldn't be afraid to be corrected. We shouldn't be afraid to be instructed. You want to get deeper with God? Allow God to correct you. And then God's going to press that flesh out of you. And he's going to press. And he's going to smite your flesh, because there's an oil. There's an oil that God has called and he has birthed for your entire life, and it comes from heaven and it flows through Jesus, and he wants it to flow out of you so that you can be a light unto this world and reach those who are lost. Please draw your attention to Isaiah chapter 4. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In verse 1, and in that day, seven women shall take hold of one man. Go with me now. Hallelujah. We will eat our own bread and wear our own apparel. So Isaiah says, there's going to be a day, gentlemen, that seven women are going to take one man. Whoa. That's a crazy day. Hold on. Let's sit at the feet of Jesus. Let's look and get our eyes focused on him. And let's start to hear spiritually. Let's get our minds away from burdens and worry. And let's look at this the way God has intended us to look at it. He says there's a day when seven women are going to take hold of one man. I want to instill hope in you today. We are the bride of Christ. And God is bringing us to the day of glory and the day of understanding, when the church will not be divided, but there will be a spiritual perfected body of Christ, and we will grab only one truth, one faith, one Lord, one baptism, one Savior, one manifested, anointed nation, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And as the bride grabs that one, as we understand, as we sit at his feet, and as we hunger for him, something's going to come out of our mouth. We're going to say, I will eat only of your bread, Jesus. I'll stay here as long as you've called, and I'm going to eat, and I'm going to feast only from what you have given me. And Jesus, I will wear the garments of praise. I will wear only the apparel that you have for me. Clothe me now. You see, when you fit at Jesus, he wants your hands still so that he can clothe you. If you're sitting at the feet of Jesus, what would your hands be doing? Would you touch him? Would you touch him? The moment you do, you're changed. You're not the same. He's put a garment of praise on you. If you've really been touched by Jesus, you have a song. You have an art. You have a dance. You have a preach. You have a word. You have a testimony, because he is alive. He is the risen Lord and Savior. And in that day, our reproach will be gone, our sin and our flesh. And in that day shall the branch of the Lord be beautiful and glorious. Hallelujah. Because now we understand who he is and who we are as the bride and the body of Christ. And the fruit, listen, the fruit of the earth in us shall be excellent and comely. God wants there to be an excellent fruit out of your mouth, an excellent fruit out of your hands, an excellent fruit, just like Daniel, out of your life for them that are escaped of Israel. How many of you this morning want to be excellent? You want to exceed the grass and go farther for excellence.
All right. We have a special for you today. We got the Winds of Fire flag team as they come and do a presentation.
Oh, Are we talking about a standard of excellence that the world considers? Or are we talking about a standard of excellence that God considers? Those two excellencies are a little bit different. Can you say amen? Honey, the word excellent also means perfect. The word excellent means no flaw, no fault in it, no contamination in it. When we have something that's excellent, it means it's been purged out of our personal opinions. It has been purged out of our personal thoughts. It is established in the word and spirit of God that it may establish you in your faith, increase your relationship with God, and release the image of Jesus Christ in you much more completely and much more fully. Amen? Now, I don't think it takes a rocket scientist to sit around and figure out pretty quick that we're living in the last days. Now, you know, someone might come and say, well, Brother Vanover, is that a couple of years? Is it 50 years? Is it 100 years? Is it 1,000 years? If it's any of those, it's short. Can you say that? Amen. Doesn't make any difference. If you say any of those, it's a short period of time in comparison to eternity. It's not very long. So one thing we have to understand is, but I think more than any other time that the church has ever faced it, we are in the last days now like we've never been before. And there needs to be a more serious approach to your relationship with God. You've got to stop playing church and you've got to start being the church. What I mean by that is there is a separation, there is a division that is taking place between God's people and those who are lukewarm. Those who are standing on the fence are getting knocked off the fence. Either you're going to be hot or you're going to be cold. For if you're lukewarm, he said he'd spew you out of his mouth. There's a division taking place, Daryl. God's going to find out who's for him and who's against him. Who is raising a standard of excellency and who is raising a standard of excellency. He's going to find that out. Amen? If you're a minister out there, you're someone out there who's got a calling and a mantle in your life, there is a lot of people that are called, and I believe their callings are real. I believe their manners are real. But I believe improper training hinders them from ever being the successful minister they could be. And let me tell you what I mean by that. Nobody's ever taught them. Nobody's ever trained them that God is a spirit. And you have to worship him in spirit and in truth. That if what you're speaking, if you're causing someone's desire, faith, and passion to go to worldly things over spiritual things, that's an error. That's not God. God's not going to do that. Understand that. God is not going to do that. You can twist it and say it and do whatever you want. God is not going to put you in a position where the world is more important to you than a relationship with God is. The relationship with God is more important. We spend our whole lives in this world trying to get more, trying to get more, trying to get more, trying to get more, trying to get more. And we're never satisfied. We're never happy. You know what I want? This is how I decided in my life. God's been this way to me. I said, God, I'm just going to be happy with whatever you give me. I was happy with the borrowed car. I was happy in a 400-square-foot apartment. I was happy in a 5,000-square-foot home. I was happy in a nice new car. And I've been happy in a jalopy and drove from here to Joplin, Missouri on ball tires, just praying all the way. And I can tell you that my state of joy and my state of happiness was the exact same with the ball tires as it was the other way. No way, because I had a relationship with God. You know why? Because God was my father. I didn't look at God as my party pack. I didn't look at God as somebody's going to give me everything I want whenever I want. I didn't look at God as a sugar daddy. I looked at God as my heavenly father. I said, God, I submit myself to your anointing. I submit myself to your word and to your power. Whatsoever you say, God, that is what I will do. And nothing else. Nothing else. Amen. Let's go on. We're in the Bible now, Job chapter 37. I'll be reading this all out of the Amplified on this passage. Job chapter 37, and we're going to start reading in the 21st verse. And now men cannot look upon the light when it is bright in the skies, when the wind has passed and cleared them. Golden brightness and splendor come out of the north. If men can scarcely look upon it, how much less upon the terrible splendor and majesty of God himself shall they look. Now, the first thing you need to understand, you learn this as a Boy Scout. I learned this as a Boy Scout. First thing you learn, there's a direction on the compass that is more important than any other direction. Do you mind what that is? It's north, right? And when you pull your compass out, it automatically goes to the north because there's a magnetic pulse that pulls it that way. But until you discover the north, until you know where the north is, you can't find the south, the east, or the west. You have to find the north first. If you find the north, then you know the east, the south, the west. You know where the rest of them are, but you got to find the north first. It's that same way in God with your spiritual compass. Your spiritual compass needs to find the north. Why? Because north is the answer to all the other directions. North is the answer. If you want God to give you direction, if you want God to give instruction, if you want God to give you understanding, find the north. And that's where to come from. And that's what the scripture, and the scripture has a spiritual connotation. I'll tell you what it means. Men cannot look upon the light when it is bright in the skies. Now, the KJV, the King James, says clouds. The Amplified says skies. Either way, in order to see that light, you have to do something. What do you have to do to see that light? What do you got to do to see that light? What do you got to do to see that light? What do you got to do to see that light? Look up. Why do we look up? Look up. From hence cometh your salvation. Look up. Get out of your flesh. Don't look at the carnality. Don't look at the world. Don't look at man's opinions. Don't look at what man thinks. Don't look at what man says. But set your eyes upward. From which cometh your salvation. Look into the face of your God. Allow the Spirit and the anointing of God to establish your feet and to establish your goings and comings. Amen? Ooh, I don't know about you. That excites me. He says, men. What does that mean? Flesh cannot handle the light of real anointing and the light of established truth. You know why people don't like messages on commitment, messages on dedication, messages on purging out your flesh and establishing the Spirit of God? Because your flesh does not like the notice of expiration. Your flesh doesn't want that. Flesh is like, no, we're going to be around forever. You got to appease me. We're going to be here forever. No, we're not. I'm just passing through to a better country. Amen. It's just for a moment, just for a second. While I'm here, I shall glorify the Lord. And then when my time comes, I shall pass into a greater opportunity. Amen? But look what he says here. I like this. He says, the light when it is bright in the skies and when the wind has passed and cleared them. I want you to look at this. What's he saying? He's saying, look, and they're not able to see the glory or the excellency of my speech. They're not able to see the glory, the excellency that comes from looking upward. He said, the problem is they need the wind to come in and blow the dust down. They need the wind to come in and to clear them. Y'all aren't listening to me. He said, all my thoughts, all my ways, all my promises, everything I bring to you, my revelation and my word, the wind clears it. The wind blows. Oh, you're not listening to me. He said in Acts chapter 2, as they came together all in one accord in one mind, the mighty rushing wind came into that room and they were filled with the Holy Ghost. And then what's he tell you here? When the wind has passed and cleared, as every element comes through, it has to be passed by the wind of God, has to be cleared by the wind of God. And what is the wind? The Holy Ghost. The breath of God has to blow on. And see, here's something that we need to learn that we're not learning. If we're going to be preachers, and if we're going to be ministers, and we're going to be out there, and we're going to say something is of God, and we're going to say something, this is a move of God, this is a work of God, then I better see some wind in that work. Oh, you're not listening to me. I better see some wind in that work. I better see some Holy Ghost. I better see some shaking of dust. I better see some establishing of a solid foundation. Now look what it says. Golden brightness and splendor that came out of where? Where'd it come out of? Where'd it come out of? Where'd it come out of? In the Spirit and the anointing. Who is the master of direction? Who is the master that gives you all guidance and direction and shows you where to go? Isn't God the director? Then who do you think sends the stuff from the north? God is sending the stuff from the north. And see, just like, oh, my Lord, help. It's like this last month or so, we've been talking about the day of the spew. There was bright light coming from the skies. Come on. And the wind blew upon it. Oh, y'all listen. Amen. And then it became golden and glorious from the north. It came from the north because all the contamination of the south had been removed. Oh, y'all ain't listening to me. Through the power of the east and the power of the west, all the contamination of the south had been transformed and changed so that when you walk into the presence and the power of the north, you can now receive direction from God in all places. It's real simple. There are four directions, north, south, east, and west. There are four images in the new creation. Father, these are told to us in Ezekiel. Father, Son, Holy Ghost, in man, in you. Four images of the new creation. So look what he says there. He goes on and says, golden brightness and splendor came out of the north. If men can scarcely look upon that, how much less upon the terrible splendor and majesty of God that he has upon himself. He says, listen, God's just wanting you to see the spiritual things coming from the north. He's just wanting you to catch hold of them. But the thing is, if you'll begin to meditate, if you'll begin to absorb, if you'll begin to activate those things that are coming from the north, if you'll begin to get them into your spiritual creation, if you'll begin to say, God, let your word be more than words on a page. God, let your revelation be something more than a concept or something someone preaches. Let it enter into my heart. Let it enter into my spirit. Let it establish my feet. And let it set my face towards you, God. Let it set my face towards you. Not only will you be able to handle the golden brightness that comes from the Lord, you someday will be able to handle the majesty of his own glory and his own anointing that is upon him. Amen? He says here, touching the Almighty, we cannot find him out. He is excellent in power and to justice and plenteous of righteousness. He does no violence, and he will disregard no right. Men therefore reverently fear him. His regards and his respects, not any who are wise in heart, in their own understanding, in their own conceit. God says, listen, man, I don't want you putting your trust and your faith in your own ability, in your own things. One of the things we have to do as ministers, we don't need to jump on it and say something is a move of God or say something's of God until we validated it as of God. And what I mean by that is, where's the scripture to support it? Where's the spiritual evidence to back it up? Where's the spiritual change in our restitution? If you can show me those elements, then I'm willing to hear you. But you got to understand something. We are not here to exalt this flesh. We are not here to stimulate this flesh. We are not here to make this flesh comfortable. We are here to release the inner man. We are here to release the spiritual creation. We are here to take this flesh, bring it under subjection, and allow the spirit. Just focus on your relationship with him. If you would focus on, you know what? I'm not giving to get anything. God, you don't own nothing else. You've already paid the price. God, you've already taken care of everything. Now, Lord, if you want to bless me, bless me. But if you don't, that's fine too. I don't care. I'm not turning my back on you. Though you slay me, yet will I serve you. Honey, if you condition people to give and get, if you condition them that way, then when they don't get it, they're not going to believe God's for them. You're going to discount, oh, Lord, help me. What you don't understand is that you are prostituting and removing the powerful sacrifice of Jesus Christ, which freed us from sin, freed us from death, gave us liberty, gave us a spiritual heritage for the rights to be the sons and daughters of a living God, a royal priesthood, and a holy nation. You're cheapening by making the sacrifice for Jesus. Oh, Lord, help me. The sacrifice for Jesus was the express line to everything I want. That's what it is. He's the express line to everything I need, to everything I desire. Let me tell you something. When you sit back and let God be a father, it will be the greatest day of your life. When you sit back and say, God, no more. It's not what I want. It's not what I desire. It's what you want. And from this day forward, I will never get more excited about the gift than the giver. I will never get more excited about the blessing over the blesser. I will be excited when I know that what's happening in me is a dynamically spiritual event that is bringing my flesh under subjection, that is releasing the Spirit of God and establishing the mind of Christ in me. First of all, you need to understand, God doesn't want you to want this world. He wants you to want Him. In order to do that, you need relationship. And relationship is not coming and talking to Him on Sunday and Wednesday and filling Him on what you need. That's not what it's about. Relationship is 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, wherever you're going, wherever you're walking. You say, God, lead me. God, direct me. As many as led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. You want to be a son, be led by a spirit. Amen. Submit yourself to a certain anointing. Something you need to get a hold of. Stay with me for just a minute. There's an excellency that comes from God. And that excellency that comes from God is perfect. It's perfect in the fact that it has no corruptible elements to it. Now, you have to understand something. If that thing coming from God is wrapped up in physical, is wrapped up in flesh, you just contaminated its purpose. Just contaminated. Now, if you leave it spiritual and you follow it spiritual and it brings an action on the physical, that's different. I mean, you're saying that's different, see, because the spirit remains the center of what you're doing. In other words, what you're doing is not based on the reaction of the action of the situation in your life. I mean, you understand what I'm saying? In other words, thank you, Lord, that's great. Just think of yourself as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And let me tell you what I mean by that. I love me some Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Let me tell you something about them. What they say, they went up to the king and said, oh, king, we are not careful to answer you. We know that our God can deliver us out of your hands. But even if he doesn't, we shall not bow. We shall not come in. See, they weren't getting excited and praising the Lord because of the action of reaction to their situation. They were saying, I don't care what the action of reaction is to my situation. I care that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. What did the Bible say? The Bible said, old Nebuchadnezzar said, turn that thing up. 7 times hotter than it was. Here's what I love. The guards that took them burned up and died. Are you listening? They died. They couldn't even get them to the furnace. That should have been something. Think about that. The guards are walking to the furnace. They get overcome with heat and die. So what do they got to do? They got to walk to the furnace themselves. Did you ever think about that? Still got to go. Still going to go. See, that's the problem with us. We don't want to get in that fire. That's the problem with us. So we want to go to church every Sunday, have us a little caramel macchiato, have us a little snack, and hear a feel-good message that makes me feel beautiful. Thank you, I'm sweet. You're so sweet. You're so beautiful. You're so awesome. You're so great. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to change anything. You're perfect just the way you are. And you walk out of there with none changed, nothing. You know what you need, man? Oh, Lord, help me, Jesus. Help me. You need some Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego experiences. What you need to do is have somebody slap that caramel macchiato out of your hand. What you need to do is have somebody pull you up and say, wait a minute, when's the last time you were in the presence of God? When's the last time that the Spirit and the anointing of God, when's the last time that moved in your life? When's the last time that happened? Amen. See, I know I make a lot of people angry. It's not my intention. My intention is I got to speak the truth. I can't lie to you. And I've been in this thing, like I said, you understand something. I didn't wake up one day, I was 8-time loser, 1-time winner for Jesus. I've known God my entire life. I was raised at the altar, filled with the Holy Ghost, preaching the Spirit of God. What my extinct experience has given me is the ability to know the difference between the real and the fake, between the authentic and the counterfeit. Because if it's authentic, there's going to be spiritual pillars holding up that wisdom, holding up that knowledge, holding up that teaching, holding up that understanding. So when people walk in those teachings, when people walk in those understandings, their relationship between them and God will increase. It will not increase because their bank account increases. It will increase because their time and relationship with God has increased. Amen? Like I said this the other day, and I stand by this. If God came to you and told you you could have anything you wanted, anything at all, you could have anything you wanted, and you say anything else other than I want all of you, I want your word, I want your spirit, I want your power, I want everything you are, I want that more important and more important than anything on this planet, you take everything else. Just give me the word, give me the spirit, give me the power, give me the anointing. If you're asking him for anything else other than that, where are your affections? Where is your heart set? What is your love? If you can't say this morning that there is nothing more important in your life than a relationship with your Heavenly Father, than understanding how to flow under his anointing, than understanding how to flow in his wisdom and knowledge, if you cannot say that today, then you don't really have affection where they need to be. Can you say amen? Let's go on. I'm going to hurry. Philippians chapter 3. Now this is Paul speaking. I want to tell you a little bit about Paul. You learned a little bit about his history right here. But there's another scripture I didn't have a chance to go to. It talks about Paul. He was raised at the feet of Gamaliel, the greatest teacher in all of Jerusalem. He's called a doctor of the law. And he's who the Sanhedrin went to ask questions and who they listened to. He's actually the same one that came along when they wanted to make public show of the disciples, when they wanted to come and persecute the disciples, they wanted to come hurt them, they wanted to do something to them. He's the one that stood up and said, you better give these men a little space. He said, you better step out of the way. Because he said, we've seen things like this before. And when others rose up and said it was God, we gave them a little space. And they eventually dismantled. They eventually faded away. He said, but you better watch out. Because if these are of God, if these men are of God, he said, we don't want to find ourselves fighting God. We don't want to find ourselves battling God. Amen? We won't find ourselves. Well, let's go real quick. Philippians. We're in Philippians chapter 3. I'm just going to start reading to you in go to the third verse. Go to the third verse. Philippians 3:3. Now this is Paul speaking to the church. For we are the circumcision which worship God in what? And rejoice in who? And have no what? I'm sorry, you have no what? We have no confidence in the flesh, but yes, all of our blessings are flesh-based. I didn't write that. That's Paul talking to the church. He said, we have no confidence in the flesh. Yet every blessing, every time we want to judge something that God has done for us, it's based on physicality and not spirituality. Isn't that right? You think about this. If all of your desires and hungers are for physical things, if all your desires and hungers are for the same thing the world wants, and can't the enemy control you whenever he wants it? He just controls you by the lust of your heart, the desires of the things you want. Here's the beauty of it. If you get in the spirit, if you realize it's not about physicality, it's not about all that, it's about the spiritual, it's about relationship, it's about flow in the anointing, it's about entering into the presence. When you figure all of that out, guess what? How's the devil going to control you? How's the devil going to move you? He can't give me revelation. He can't give me established truth. He can't give me understanding. He can't create in me the ability to maintain a powerful and anointed relationship with my Heavenly Father. He can't do that. So guess how much control the devil now has over you? Zero. As long as you're speaking, looking at spiritual elements, the devil can't control you. The devil controls you when you look at the physical. Devil controls you in the flesh. Can I show you something? Let me show you something. As long as Peter looks at Jesus, he walked on the water. When he began to look to the right and he began to look to the left, when he began to take knowledge of the physicality of the situation, he began to sink. And Jesus reached down his hand, lifted him back up, and they walked out to the boat, right? Same thing today. As long as you keep your eyes on Jesus, you can walk over any problem. As long as you keep your eyes on Jesus, you can walk over any situation. As long as you keep your eyes on Jesus, he'll bring you through any problem. But the moment you start taking account of what's to the right and what's to the left, when you start acknowledging the physicality, you remove the power of the spirituality. Oh, y'all don't hear me. When you empower the physicality, you remove the spirit of the spirituality. And you say, brother, that's not Bible. Oh, yes, it is. For the flesh and spirit are contrary one to another. You cannot do both and still do what you need to do. Amen. One is contrary to the other. You got to make a decision. We have to make a decision. Amen. I love what Paul says here. He says, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he have whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. See, Paul's looking at him and said, listen, if you think you can trust in this flesh, if you think you can trust in your own analysis, your own research, your own wisdom, your own understanding, if you think you can do all that, he said, if there's anybody that should be able to think like that, it should be me. So if there's anybody, even I more, should have more confidence in my flesh and more confidence in my carnality. Look what he says here. Circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of a Hebrew. And it's touching the law of Pharisee. Concerning zeal and persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. I want you to stop. This is Paul. He's laying out his credentials. Now, it also says in there, he received letters from the high priest. And he could go in, and he did this quite often. He would put men and women and children into jail if they mentioned the name of Jesus, if they said they believed in Jesus. So he was a very, very zealous persecutor of the Christian faith. Now look what he says. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Whatever former things I had that might have been gains to me, oh, come on, hear me now. I have come to consider as one complete combined loss for Jesus Christ. Now, something you need to understand about Paul, being circumcised that day of the tribe of Benjamin, is touching the law of Pharisee, raised the feet of Gamaliel, the greatest teacher in all of Jerusalem. If you were looking at Paul today, he'd have a PhD in theology. That's how much training he had. That's how much power he had. But I want to tell you something. He said, everything I ever learned, everything they ever told me, everything they ever showed me, he said, I just realized something. It is lost. It has no power to it. It has no ability to it. It has nothing to bring me into a relationship with God. I have studied and zealously studied, and yet none of it brought me to Jesus Christ. None of it. Look what he says. Yea, doubtless. I love this scripture. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss. For what? I'm sorry, for what? For the what? Excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, of whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and but do count them as what? What do you count them as? Dung. I like the way Amplified says it. Yes, furthermore, I count everything as lost compared to the possession of the priceless privilege, the overwhelming preciousness, the surpassing worth, the supreme advantage, man, I like that, of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord, and the progressively becoming deeply and ultimately acquainted with him, of perceiving and recognizing and understanding him more fully and clearly for his sake. I have lost everything and consider it to be mere rubbish, refuge, dregs, in order that I may win and gain Christ the anointed. Don't you understand? Paul had all the training you could get in your flesh. Paul had all the training men could give him. There's not a school today that could have trained anybody in the ways of religion and the ways of legalism like Paul was trained at the feet of Gamaliel. But yet he stood before you and he said, it's not man's training that brought me into Jesus. It's not man's wisdom that brought me into Jesus. But it was on the road to Damascus when that bright, oh, somebody hear me. When that bright shining light out of the north came and I couldn't behold it, I couldn't see it because I was blinded by my flesh, I was blinded by my religion, I was blinded by my doctrine, I was blinded for 3 days. I did not eat and I did not drink and I was blind. One for the Father, one for the Son, one for the Holy Ghost. And then all of a sudden, a little man named Ananias picked up the spiritual courage God gave him, walked down that street, came up to that man that had put men, women, and children into prison, that had put to death men and women and children that proclaimed the gospel of Jesus Christ, walked into that same man's house and said, Jesus sent me. Laid his hands on Paul, and the Bible tells us, as it were, scales fell off of his eyes, and he began to see. Now, I know some people compare that maybe to the scales of fish or the scales of something else, but I think it was the scales of weight, the weight of wisdom, the weight of judgment, the weight of understanding, the weight of knowledge, the ability to weigh and judge things was changed instantaneously. And all of a sudden, now get this, man. Who he could not see in that bright and shining light. He now not only saw, but he became greatly acquainted. Can you say praise God? Greatly acquainted with. And see, that's why Paul's so strong on this subject. I wish more preachers were strong on this subject, but Paul is strong on this subject. That's why he's so strong on this subject when he tells you it is not physical, it is spiritual. When he tells you get out of the physicality, he said if anybody should have trusted in flesh, if anybody should have put their confidence in flesh, it was me. And yet I counted it worthless. For the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus. I'm not going to get a chance this morning to talk to you and show you exactly where that excellence is. But I can tell you that everything that comes from God, God doesn't do things impartial. He doesn't do them in part. He does them in full. When he comes, he wants to bring you full wisdom, full knowledge. Full understanding. Can you say praise the Lord? Let me finish up here. He goes on and says, yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung that I may win Christ, and be found in him not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through faith in Jesus Christ, the righteousness which is in God by what? See, Paul was making a very strong statement here. Paul said, I've been trained in every way there was to be trained. I had letters from the high priest. I was supported in every way. I was zealous in my faith. I was blameless in my faith. He said, but none of that took me to Jesus. None of that took me to the excellency. And so now that I see the excellency, now that I know the excellency of Jesus Christ, he said, my righteousness is no more established on the legalism of the law. My righteousness is no longer established on religion. But from this day forward, my righteousness will be established about relationship between me and my heavenly Father. Can you say amen? There's two kinds of excellency. The things the world calls excellent, the things the world calls perfect, they will always be contaminated. They will always have a corruptible element because they are created from the desire and the lust of flesh. But the excellency of Christ, this is the best part. Excellency of Christ comes from the heart of God. And that excellency is perfect. It has no corruptible elements in it. And that's what God is wanting. God is driving his church and driving his bride in a position they've never been before, a position of excellency, a position where we're no longer following every little sly wind and craftiness whereby man lay in wait to deceive, but where we stand and we hold accountability. Is it the word? Is it the spirit? Is it the power of God? Does it establish you? Does it bring you in a relationship? Or is it just hokey pokey? Everybody feels like they had a move of God. Let me tell you something. We don't need to fake a move of God. We live in a move of God. And you say, praise God, every day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The choice is yours, my friend. You can get fool's gold, which is the world's idea of excellency, or you can go to the gold standard, which is God's idea of excellence. G-O-L-D, God's overcoming living direction. You need that gold standard. When the fire hits the word, it removes all inferior elements. It removes all misconceptions. It removes everything. And you take that word and brings it forth. What's the Bible tell us? As pure gold. And when we have pure gold, what do we have? Through the word, through the spirit, we have God's overcoming living direction. Gold. Amen. We have gold. Amen. Praise God.
All the youth come here. If I didn't call you, you come up here. You're part of this youth group. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Pick up your hands and begin to pray. Begin to put your mind on the Lord. Oh, get in a straight line. No, I don't want nobody behind each other. Y'all get over here. Make some room for all of them. Just spread out. I want you to hold hands. Our future is so powerful. Our future is so powerful. There are no limits to what you can do for God. You are in a ministry that teaches commitment, that teaches for you to give all to the Lord. And you might find from time to time people around you that will come and whisper in your ear and try to convince you that life outside of ministry, outside of serving God, is more or better or greener. But I'm going to tell you right now, I was once your age. I was once your age. And I wanted to kill myself. I wanted to commit suicide because I was so depressed. I did not have God until I gave my life to him at 18 years old. So at 14 years old, who's 14 here? Who's 12 years old? Israel. At this age, I wanted to kill myself. There is nothing better for you than where you're at. Do not listen to the lies of the enemy. He is a liar. He is a thief. He comes to kill, to steal from you, and to destroy you. He wants to destroy you, Zoe. You're a powerful instrument in the hand of God. He wants to destroy you because you hold the Holy Ghost in your vessel. He wants to destroy you, Marissa. Because there's a promise that's been made to you that you would have a greater anointing. That's what's in my life. He wants to destroy you, Mario, because he wants to pull you away from the very life source that's been given to you. He wants to tear you apart because you can look at a soul and see what they need. He wants to destroy you because you were birthed in a ministry that has everlasting life as its promise. He wants to destroy you and pull you away and carry you away in the lies of the world. Do not listen. Do not listen. Do not listen. I even speak this to you right now as a young girl. Don't ever listen to those around you that don't serve God. But have your ear to the master. You will be used in a great way, daughter. Don't ever turn your ear to the enemy. Don't let depression ever come close to you. Don't. You have an inheritance that you don't even understand. It's so powerful. That's waiting at the brink. Oh. Depression, oppression, I bind in Jesus' name. It will not come into my home and it will not touch my children in the name of Jesus. Oh, don't look at yourself and think, I don't ever want to hear someone tell me, even your own mother, I never want to hear you say out of your mouth, I'm done. Don't you ever say that. You are not dumb. You speak that to yourself, and it's not a lie that the enemy comes and tells you. Do you remember when I prophesied to you many years ago that your hands would create? That prophecy is still intact. There are great things for you to do in the kingdom of God. Do not tell yourself that you're dumb. I want you to say this from now on. I am a vessel of the Lord, and I am called by the great I am, and I have a promise from the Lord, and I will do great and mighty things. I want someone to write that down, and he needs to say that to himself every day. Oh, yes. Oh, your mouth is anointed. Your mouth is anointed. The devil is a liar. He wants to come and discourage you and tell you you're no good. That lying devil, he doesn't see the power that is inside of you. Oh, he's scared of it. That's what it is. Because when you pray and when you cry out and when you speak the word of God, it causes young people to draw to the Lord. Use what God has given you. The devil is a liar. Hamahasanda. He is a liar. You have been birthed in a ministry. That can hold. You can hold. The Lord wants me to tell you, you can hold the anointing inside of you and lay hands on people. When you lay hands on the sick, Bible says they will recover. These hands are anointed to pray. You might flood your mind right now with, but what about this? What about that? I think this way, or those thoughts. That's what the Lord wants to teach you, to bring every thought captive under the obedience of Jesus Christ. Philippians 2 and 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. On the lama, see, that will be your scripture. You need to read that to yourself every day for 20 and 23 and set yourself to change the way you think about yourself, the way you think about things. Homahasa. And when you do that, your hands will flow in anointing to pray like you've never seen.
Hello, my name is Ryan Colley. I'm International Evangelist and Administrative Vice President of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We'd like to thank you so much for tuning into our program today. And if you would like to help us take revival around the world to our friends in Honduras, Mexico, Singapore, and Malaysia, this is how you can do it. First off, you can send in your checks or money orders to 1005 Southwest 4th Street in Moore, Oklahoma, 73160. You can also call in with credit card at 405-793-1777. That's 405-793-1777. And finally, you can do it through the Cash App. That's money sign RFC ROAR. That's money sign RFC ROAR. Thanks in advance for helping us take the flame around the world. Remember, we are a ministry with a vision built on a plan, the Word of God.